So, hello from me. I'm Spiros, and actually together with Giovanni, we're going to talk about plugin design principle, and actually it's actually testing your plugins. So you saw that how you can actually have your plugins in AiiDA with a new system. Now it's a question actually, how do you develop these plugins? So when you develop a plugin, in general a program, what you want to verify is actually that the plugin can be executed, for example, without exceptions. You have to provide a valid and sound program that runs, first of all. Actually what you should provide also is like your plugin that you provide should be compatible with AiiDA. So you provide a program that should work with another platform, let's say, which is AiiDA, and all these should be compatible and should be checked every time. Then another thing that we saw actually in the previous presentation is that there are various requirements that come with AiiDA. So it's AiiDA itself, and actually depends on other software that also have different versions. So when you develop something, you should actually test that it's not only compatible with AiiDA, but should also be compatible with what comes with AiiDA. Then there are some questions about you. So you have a plugin. So actually the plugin is actually what prepares actually, the files that you will give, for example, a code, there will be the input of a code, and then you take the output of a code, you parse it, and you give it back to the AiiDA. So, actually, your also, in quotation mark, job is actually to know that it works with the code that you design, for example, a plugin, and actually, you can, it works also with various outputs of the code. So, as you see here, there are various levels of what you have to test, and all of them are not really obvious. And at least to me, it is not very obvious. And at the same time, when you develop something, you start to do some manual tests. But the problem with the manual testing is that it's a bit cumbersome, it's a bit boring, and it's actually inefficient. So what I would do, I would, for example, start testing or doing some of these tests. When I would develop, I may do, for example, 10 tests of that kind. And when I do some change, maybe I will test 5 of these things. And when my collaborator comes and helps me to develop something together, then he will do 1 test, and then we arrive at a place that we introduce bugs. So then this starts not to scale. And the problem is that it's the manual testing. So we can go on something which is likely like automated testing. So you can express what you want to test in a series of automated tests. So I know my code, I know what I've written, and I know that what's important to test for this thing. So actually I can write some automated test. So the good with this is actually that you can test it fast. So I develop something, I can run fast my tests since they are automated. And actually this is very helpful for other people. So someone comes after me, has to see my code, and actually has to actually extend it. So it can look at the test and also understand what I think is also crucial about my code. So having some tests that actually are automated and run whenever I want is very good and actually helps to advance faster and have less bugs in our program. The problem with this, the local automated test, is that people usually neglect them. So it has happened to me, it has happened to us, that we develop something and then want to do a minor change, the test takes some time, and we say that this will not break anything, we just commit it, and in the end it breaks something. And tomorrow we leave for a conference, someone else wants to work on the code, and we are in a state that doesn't advance. So what's the best, and actually the approach that we follow now is actually the online automated testing. So what we want to achieve is actually on every commit or on every change, there is an automated, let's say, environment that actually checks and runs all the tests, and if everything succeeds, it allows you to put the new changes in this. So we want a platform that actually automatically tests the later version of provided plugins, checks version compatibility, and checks the results. And actually, it prohibits the insertion of bugs and breaking existing code. So if this happens, usually this results to a more stable ecosystem, to more happy users, and actually to happy developers. And we get less complaints, actually, from users that something is not working. Then the question is how to do it. So this can be done we follow the approach of having a lightweight virtual machines, which is Docker. So Docker, I don't know if you know what's a virtual machine, or so a virtual machine is actually a virtual computer that can run inside your computer or in other computers. So it's something that contains all the needed software in order to run, for example, a program, etc. And Docker is a light version of, in general, virtual machines. So what Docker does is actually that guarantees that you all run the same, your program will have the same behavior, let's say, regardless of the environment it's running in. So you can run, for example, your program in a Docker environment, and the Docker environment can be on your Mac, maybe can be on a supercomputer, can be on your desktop, which can be Windows, Linux, or anything. A bit about the Docker architecture. You have, let's say, on your computer, you have a client and you have a host. The host has various images. When you run an image, it goes into a container, and all this is handled by a daemon. When you want to interact, actually, with the host that runs on your computer, you have a client that has various commands, for example, Docker build, pull, run, etc. And actually, when you execute these commands, the client contacts the host and actually interacts with the host and gets back some replies. So this happens on your computer. And then you have a registry where you actually can actually push some of your images and get them back. A bit more about the images. So a Docker image is actually a series of layers. So a Docker image, for example, this is pretty good. Actually, for example, I want to install Ubuntu. Ubuntu is an image, and this has various layers. And the good with this is actually that these layers are also independent. So this can be also served by different images. Maybe this is not important for you, but the good with this is actually you have to save space. So if I want to have Ubuntu, let's say this version 15, and someone else another version, and they have some things in common, you don't have to actually download all these layers and have them independent. So this is how you save space comparing to traditional, let's say, virtual machines. That all these, you have to duplicate it if you want it again. So layers are updated independently. They're combined in a single file system. And when you want to run, for example, this image, what happens is actually you have a container. So you take this image, which is actually a read-only image, so you cannot modify it. And you add, actually, on top a layer where you can read and write. And then, actually, it behaves like a real machine. And if you want to run it again and have another container that runs this specific version of Ubuntu 15.04, what will happen is actually have another, a second layer. So this shows that you download the minimum code, and actually, you save space. And why this is good? This is good because all this will happen online, and this has to be a bit lightweight. So we don't have too much space to have all the virtual machine to have gigabytes of data. For example, the virtual machine that I use for development is about 15 to 20 gigabytes. So you cannot have this 3-4 times, for example. So I also talked about, we talked about this part. So let's see about the registry. Let's talk a bit about the registry. So when you develop one of your images, you can push it to the registry. So registry, for example, stores images. So you can take some images from the registry, and you can push actually the images to a public registry, a registry like Docker Hub. So when you want something, you can just pull it from a registry by defining a specific file. We'll see later. For example, now we also have, for example, in Docker Hub, there's also an AiiDA team folder with store SSH and other, actually, images that you could use. You can use, actually. An example of a Docker file. So the question is, these are all nice, but how do we use them? So in order to, let's say, download and run an image, you can start by having a Docker file. And Docker file is like a text file like this that tells you from which image you inherit, from where do you start. Some things that you would like, for example, commands we like to run, some environment variables and other commands, and in the end, actually, you get to some, let's say, an execution point. So, for example, here, the from will tell you that you start from an image, the base image. Then you can actually define who maintains the specific file. And then you can run some commands, and you can define environment variables, copy files that you think that they're important inside the image. And then, OK, I don't think that I defined the working directory, but you can define the working directory. When you do such things, it's also important, actually, inside the Docker file, it's important, let's say, to, if you create some temporary files, like happens here, try to clean them in the same line. But this is a bit advanced, maybe, for this discussion. But the good thing, and what I would like to remain from this thing, is like by defining a file like that, and by executing this file, you end up actually with an image that has this thing installed, this thing copied, and you arrive at this working directory. And we'll see how it goes. So, for example, we had this Docker file and want to create, let's say, to build the image. So we say, let's say, a command like a client command, like Docker build. We say that we use the Docker file that's in the current directory, and we add the tag to it. So actually, it builds an image for the Docker file. The Docker file is the current folder, and after building it, it adds the tag. After doing this, theoretically, what we'd like to do is actually see where we stand. So we can list our images by doing Docker images and see what we have in our laptop, let's say, or computer. So the result, for example, of this would be, for example, one of these images. For example, AiiDA core base. So one entry of this would be one of the images. So note that the image is something that's read-only. So if we want to execute it, we have to create a container. So now we would like to run an image. So I would like to run Ubuntu in interactive mode, and I would like to run Bash inside Ubuntu. So create me an image, create a container in order to be able to run it. So create the Ubuntu image, add a layer, so create a full container, and then I would like actually to run bin bash and be able to execute some commands. So this is what this command will do. So you execute this. It says in the beginning that, at least on my machine, since I didn't have Ubuntu inside Docker, that I couldn't find it. So starts downloading various layers. So you see, I mean, it starts to download them. And then at some point it finishes, tells you that download the newer image for Ubuntu, and then gives you access directly. So you are root in this virtual machine, and you can do whatever you want. So overall, when we run this command, what happens actually is that it pulls the image, creates a new container with a read-write later, allocates a file system, adds an IP, executes a process that you specify, actually a bus, and then, of course, capture returns the output if it's something that's not interactive. For example, even an interactive actually does this. What's important to mention here is that when the process finishes, the modifications are discarded. So unless specified something, you do something different, whatever you run, if you don't keep it, it's discarded. Is it clear until now, more or less, at least? Are there any questions?
Just to maybe can I add one thing?
Yeah.
Just, we are telling all this, and we'll show in a moment, because the idea of this is to have an easy way to create a computer, a virtual environment, which has everything installed, Ubuntu, AiiDA, potentially your plugin, etc. So you can easily test again the same code over and over. Okay. All the purpose is the technical part, because you need to understand the seven commands, you need to understand to know how Docker works. But we are showing this with the aim that you are able to install in a small computer, virtual computer in Docker, AiiDA, your plugin, the your code with the CI stack, quantum express, etc., put them together, connect them via SSH, and try if your plugin is able to submit and get the calculation. But as you can imagine, this requires a lot of dependencies, right? It requires to install your Fortran code, requires to install AiiDA, requires to install the dependencies. Having this, so this approach allows you to write just this Docker file that Spiros showed you. You define what you have to do to install everything. And then also everything works together, and you will see later, at every commit, you can even check if the plugin is still able to submit. Okay? So up to here, you saw how to define a virtual machine and to run it.
Yeah,
and Spiros is going to show more commands.
And also keep in mind that what we try to emulate here is like having a computer, which is your computer, that has, for example, AiiDA, having a supercomputer that runs Torque, and all this actually should cooperate. And we have also a third computer that has the database. So these are three computers that we try to emulate more or less here. So three computers also take space, and this is how why we follow this approach, because we have to save space and put them something which is pretty minimal. It runs online and runs on every commit, actually. So on every change that you will do, what Giovanni will show later, is that all these things, if it's configured correctly, which actually will do most of the configuration, you'll do some minor changes, will run and will execute and the test that you specify. And will test your plugin. So that's the main idea here. So we continue with some Docker commands just to have an understanding of what is Docker and how it works. So for example, I would like to see all my containers. So I had something running, for example. I had Ubuntu running. And when I, for example, had, if I type Docker PS, what I get is actually the running virtual machines, actually the running containers. And since I exited Ubuntu, I don't see it here. So if I, for example, define minus A, I get also the ones that are not used anymore. Like this one that exited, let's say, 5 seconds ago. Then there are various commands. For example, if you have something which is long running, for example, Ubuntu, it was something that started, did something, and exited. But you see the others are running a bit more in a daemon mode. I can, for example, connect to them and actually run a command. For example, here, I say docker exec and connect as specific user, which is user AiiDA, to the container with this ID and actually start a bash shell. And by doing this, actually execute this and arrive at that machine as user AiiDA. And then I can continue working. If I want to kill something, it's easy. So when you don't need any more a specific container, you can kill it. For example, this is what I did, for example, with my Ubuntu container. I had it running. I did a Docker PS. I had it running. I didn't need it anymore. So instead of, for example, exiting the normal way, I decided to kill it. So I did a Docker kill with ID. In the end, it was killed. So this is how, more or less, you can manipulate your images, which are read-only, your containers, which are actually a place to run your images, and play and understand and see how things work in this world. You can remove a specific container with Docker remove by specifying the ID, and you can also remove the image. So if it's specific image that you don't want anymore, you do Docker images, you find the one that you think is not needed anymore, you do and remove image with the ID, and it's removed, and you see the layers that are removed. So it does the cleaning. So the question is, how do I arrive from one image, this is what we saw, to three images, which what will Giovanni show? So we want one that contains AiiDA, another that contains database, and another which will be the server that will actually execute the code, and you will connect to that and execute something, get the result, and pass the results. So in order to do that, they have defined, let's say, a component, let's say, which is called Docker Compose. Actually, it's a tool And with this tool, you can define and run multi-content Docker applications. And these applications, as soon as you define them, they communicate via virtual network. So we can start our AIDA, our database, and our supercomputer. So you define everything in a Docker file, your application, for example, AIDA. You define the services that make up your application, for example, the database and the REST, in a specific file which is called Docker Compose, and then you start the whole thing. And if you want to have a look and understanding of how is Docker Compose, this is how it looks like. You don't have to go into many details, just have a look that we have services. We have a database service that has specific volumes. We have something which Torque SSH, which is actually the server that hosts the code. And AIDA will submit everything here and will get the results. So this is where you submit something, you prefer the files, you send them there, and you'll parse the files that this will give you back. And then you have AIDA with specific volumes. And you have dependencies. So this is an understanding of, I hope this gives you an understanding of what we use in the background, that we have three machines and how more or less interact. And I think now it's Giovanni that will give you more insight on how these interact.
So do you have questions up to now?
So maybe I'll go through my part, which a bit uses this, so you will see a bit better why we are explaining this. So as we said, what's the final aim of this session? So just bear with me, we have 15 more minutes and we are done. So I know it's almost lunchtime. So the aim is to help, to give a tool where you have to just modify four files and gives you the possibility to run at every commit of your code automatic tests for your plugins or your workflows. So we strongly suggest that people, especially for Max, people who are contributing to plugins, try to use this because it will help us also to help you check what you're doing, but it's really for everybody. So that's what we want to get. Okay, we want to have you that commit on GitHub, and at every commit, there is a service which I'm going to present, it's called Travis, which in some cloud machine will create an environment with three computers, basically. One for AIDA, one with your code plugin, one for database, and one with the fictitious cluster with SSH, a scheduler, and your code. Connect them between them and run some tests to basically submit something, get the results back, and see if the parsing was successful or not. As you can imagine, configuring all this requires some work. You have to install Fortran, OpenMP, OpenMPI, compile your code, then you have to put the plugin into AIDA, etc. What Spiros just presented, which is Docker, is a way to make it automatic, okay? So how does it work? So they say that the technology we chose is not the only way to do it, is that every of these three boxes is a Docker container, so a small virtual machine, and Docker Compose will connect them in a kind of network. So you can really use the network, the standard network, like to speak, to make them speak together. So what we did was to make a simple template, actually two, one for Quantum Espresso, so you already see how it works for Quantum Espresso. And one simpler, which I'm just going to show you here, which is just a simple calculation which takes a number, multiplies it by two, and gets back. So again, we are always using here very simple codes just to avoid that you see the complicated. So you get focused on the complicated part just to see the infrastructure. And the idea is we provide you a template, you just copy the folder, modify these files we are going to mention, and basically you are ready to test your code. So the files with the templates are in this repository. It's in GitHub, AIDA team, AIDA Docker Compose. Okay, it's here. What you can do, you can fork it, modify, and contribute back with the modifications. Here, as I say, there are a few examples. What you can do, for instance, you can take the test AIDA Quantum Espresso PW, which is a test we already did for Quantum Espresso. And I'm going to show the four files that you have to modify. So you take this, you can create a copy, and let's say you do test AIDA Siesta. Okay, that's the first thing you do. Inside this folder, you find a set of files. You don't need to, I mean, some are technical. If you really want to understand, you can go and understand what all these files are doing. These are files we prepared for you. You just have to modify these four files, okay? So I'm going to go through them one by one. You will have to modify a Docker file, in which you write the instructions to install your code. So you want to install Siesta, you have to do a git clone or download it with wget. unzip it, compile it, and make sure it works. Then you have to modify the Dockerfile for AiiDA to install your plugin. So currently, in the old version, you had to copy the plugin files into the AiiDA folder. With the new system, which Rico showed, you have to pip install your plugin. So get it and install it. So that's the second file you have to modify. And then you have to modify two more files. One is just the information you want to give to AiiDA when you do Verdicode setup. You have to tell, look, I have a code installed on this machine, which is called Quantum Espresso, and is in /usr/bin/pwtext. Just, we saw it, just 7 lines. And finally, you have to write some tests, which typically are composed by 2 parts. You submit your code, you submit your calculation through AiiDA, and then you check if when the calculation is finished, if the results are what you expect. If everything works, the system will tell you the plugin is working. Okay. If at any step something crashes, you are not able to install your code, the plugin doesn't install, or you're not able to submit, etc., you get a failure. And actually, we show in the last slides how this actually shows up directly on GitHub. It's very convenient. So let's go through these 4 files one by one. The first thing you want to do is to have a computer in which you have your code running. So you modify your Dockerfile, and you know, the Dockerfile for Quantum Espresso, it's a lucky case, it's this. It's just this, okay? What you do is just say, you start from something we already prepared for you, which is Torque SSH base. It's something we prepared with Ubuntu, SSH connection, and a small scheduler, which in our case is Torque. Just because, and this is something everybody needs, and you don't need to change it. The only thing you want to do, so this is something you don't need to change, don't worry, you just need to install your code. If you're lucky, like in this case, it's fine to have your old version, you just want Quantum Espresso from Ubuntu, you just do apt-get update, apt-get install Quantum Espresso and OpenMPI if you want to test also the parallel version, and that's it. You can clean up to reduce the space of the image, but that's not essential. So by just writing this, you have your code installed. You have to do the same thing for your code. So imagine you have, again, the case of Siesta. Probably you, I don't know if there is anything on Ubuntu, but you can do, instead of this, you do a wget from your specific version you want to get, untar, make, etc. You do what you would do in your computer. The nice thing is that this runs in a specific version of Ubuntu, which is provided by us, but actually by Ubuntu itself. So you know that if you write something here, this is always going to work. If you specify a specific version of Siesta. So you write down what you know it works, you try, if it doesn't work, you fix it. At the end, anybody who wants to run this will be able to have immediately a Siesta version working, which, by the way, is also useful beside AiiDA. I mean, just if you want to have a person just trying out what Siesta does, you can just give this and use the command Spiros showed, just do a Docker pull Siesta and you can try it. So after you do this, you try it and you have the supercomputer, let's say, with your code. The second step is to install your plugin. So we already provide, again, a Docker file which does everything for you for AiiDA. So installs a specific version of AiiDA and installs some scripts to make all these magic things happen together. The only thing you have to do is to add something to actually install your plugin. So typically, you will have to add this block, these few lines, where you clone a specific plugin. Okay. Typically, you go inside, you might want to check out a specific branch or a specific commit if you know it works. And then here, which I didn't write, depending on how your plugin is installed, you just write the lines you need to run to install the plugin. It could be a pip install -e, or in the old version, it could be a copy of files. Okay. So again, after this, we already provide you a Docker container, so a virtual machine with AiiDA installed. You just installed also your plugin. So now you have these 2 computers. The third computer is a database, and there we don't have to do much. It's, again, a virtual machine, if you want, provided by Postgres. It works. So these are the three machines we have. The only thing you have to do is now to tell AiiDA how to speak to this code. And this you do by just creating this 7-line file, where 2 lines are empty, actually. Where basically you just pass the inputs you would type in Verdi code setup. So Verdi code setup asks this information, code label, you can put a label you want, a description. Then is local is typically false because it means that the code is installed on the supercomputer. Here that's tricky, that's essential, you have to put the code, the name of the plugin you developed. In this case it's Quantum Espresso PW, this is the name of the plugin for AiiDA. Name of the computer is always Torque SSH, is the one we configured for you. And the final thing you have to change is the location where you installed your executable. So if you installed here, as you saw before, I installed Quantum Espresso with apt-get install, so it went up here. But if you installed CSI in a specific folder, here you have to put the correct folder where you installed AiiDA. Your code. So that's the third file. So this is quite simple to change. So at this point, you have the three machines ready to run, and automatically this file is going to be run when you start everything. So basically, AiiDA will be set up also with your code. The final thing is to actually write the tests to check that you are able to submit and get back what you expect. And so you have to go in this file, which is called test plugin. You can take it and modify it. Typically, this is done in two parts. The top part is a standard way in which you submit calculations through AiiDA. Actually, also for the Max people, we asked you to write a few of these examples, like VCRLAX, SCF. So just take a code, which will be the code name you chose before, create a calculation, put the input, store, and submit. That's very exactly the same thing you would do normally. And then in the second part of the file, you have to test what happens. So we already provide a bunch of code which does this. You can change it. It's very primitive if you want, but does the job. What it does is up to a given timeout of typically a couple of minutes. It waits 15 seconds. It checks, it prints on the output of where the calculation list. So just if you go in the log, you see what's happening. When the calculation finishes, it takes the energy, compares with some hard-coded value you know the code should return. If it's OK, it exits with zero exit code, which means successful. If there is an error, it prints out the values and returns a non-zero error code. That's a really essential thing. You are exiting the script with zero if everything is fine, and with non-zero if there is an error, because that's what is checked by a system to tell if the test failed or not. So in the end, you want this file. It's just a Python file which submits something, waits for it to finish, and then checks some values. Okay? If at any step something fails, you are not able to submit, you don't find the plugin, or the result is not expected one, this will fail. And this will show up in GitHub, as I show you. So once you modify these four files, that's ready to test your plugin. When you run this one, the only thing you can do is create a pull request back to us so we have this testing. Okay, so you had copied this in a new folder, you modify these four files, you make a pull request, which basically means you contribute back the modification to this main repository. In this way here, we can host the tests for the plugins we know are supported by AiiDA. So how does this, so a summary, okay? We have managed to create an infrastructure, and I didn't show you the details. This runs Docker Compose, etc., and all the files are there. I'm just trying to give you the few things you need to modify if you want to try it. We have three machines connected together. There is AiiDA working, there is a cluster with your code working, and there is a test environment. And the two scripts, if you want to play with it, are one, which is this one in the template folder, which is startup first time. If you run it, it will initialize the three machines, put the SSH keys in the right place, initialize Verdi, do all the Verdi setup, Verdi configure setup, etc., and prepare this environment. And then by just running ./testcompose, it will run the correct Docker command to run this test. Here, end of this SSH, run the code, get back the results, and test. Okay. So basically, if you modify those four files, you can just run then these two scripts, and everything works as you want. The only final thing I want to show in two screenshots, basically, is how to make this run at every commit. There are many ways, which this is called continuous integration. Every time you do modification, you want to test your code. This might seem a bit boring, but I tell you, for sure, if you work with other people, that's what you want to do. But even if you work alone, having something which tests every commit helps really a lot. You have to spend maybe a day or two to make it working. And actually, with Travis, it's very simple. But it really saves time. And one service we're going to show you is called Travis. It's an online service which is free for repositories which are on GitHub and are public. So if you have a public repository on GitHub, you can just connect it with Travis. It's for free. And every committee will run some tests typically, okay? The nice thing is it's very well integrated with GitHub. So if you go in the list of commits in GitHub, every time you push something, it runs a test. While it's running is a yellow circle, it means it's running. And when you finish, if the test fails, you have a red cross. If the test passes, you have a green check. So So it's really, you go on GitHub, you see immediately which commits were good and which commits were bad. You see here I was trying to fix something. At some point I managed to fix. And if you click on this, you go on the Travis webpage, which for each commit you have, it runs a test and it shows you this was connected to this Git commit, but this failed. And this was this Git commit and it passed and so on. And even more, if you click on it, you can see the log. So this is everything it did. This collapsed, it's just the installation of AiiDA, et cetera. You see here, maybe it's a bit small, it ran these two commands I mentioned before, as a startup first time, and then test compose. And you see here what happened. If for some reason, I forgot to install the plugin, probably, and there is an error. So I see a red cross, I click, I go in the log, and I see what is the problem. I can fix it, commit again, a new test starts. And just to mention, it's very simple to enable it. You need two things. You need the first bit to enable it. And it's just a matter of logging in Travis CI with GitHub. So you just say login with GitHub, and it logs in. You get a list of all your repositories. You just click here, and it's activated. Okay, the two are connected. Once you are going to commit something on your repository, Travis knows has to do something. The only other thing you have to do is to tell Travis what to do, right? So he cannot know. And you have to write a file called .travis.yml. It's a file you put in the home of your repository, which has, this is a simple one. It can be very complicated, but typically a very simple one does the job. This is the top part. You just say, basically, I want to be able to use sudo in my virtual environment. Basically, it works like Docker behind the scenes. It has a small virtual machine which is started for you. You want to use Python. You need some services. And if you put more virtual environments, that's also nice. Basically, if you put here, you see two virtual environments, it will run two independent virtual machines at every commit. It runs two different tests in two completely different machines, one for one plugin and one for another. And then below this, you say what you actually want to do. And this typically might have up to three phases. You have something to do before the installation, something to actually install your code, and something to test. These are called before install, and specify the syntax of Travis. Here, I mean, for instance, what I'm doing, I'm just replacing the Docker Compose to a most updated version. Here I'm running this startup first time, which is the script I wrote to prepare everything, start the three virtual machines, connect them, and et cetera. And finally, I run my test compose, which is just running the plugin test, so it's submitting and waiting. Any of this phase, you get a red cross. Okay, so that's really a good way to test, because once you do a commit, even if you don't want to test everything, you just try and you see what happens. Imagine you change the code itself, or change the plugin, or change something, you immediately see if it's working. And the nice thing is that we already provide a Travis YML file in the template repository, so you don't even have to write this file. You just have to really get a folder, copy, and modify those four files, and everything will run for you. And if you want to have more complicated setups, we can discuss. I mean, yeah.
If you have a unique test set, I think you should cover a number of features so that the resources that you need to run that they expect to be large. I'm thinking about also other projects, you know, like Yambo or Quantum Espresso. So how many resources are we provided? So are those tests meant to be super short?
Yeah.
Or can those be run parallel?
So say in the free version of Travis, you have a number of machines that can run. Basically, I think they have something around 1,000 machines available, and anybody on GitHub who commits accesses to these resources on the free tier. Typically, means that in most cases there is one free. So if you commit, you get immediately your test running, and after a few minutes you get the result. GitHub allows you to prevent merging into a branch if there is a problem. Or that's even very nice of this. If someone gets a pull request on your branch or your fork, you don't need to get it and try it, but the test runs automatically even before you merge. Okay? So this means that you typically should try to do something which is very short. In a few minutes, you know if it's working or not. So the tests you want to put on Travis are really minimal. You do, you know, very simple. Don't have to be physically meaningful converge calculation. You really have to run in a few seconds typically. You might run in parallel. Of course, you typically have one CPU available, so it will be slower. But you can try the code anyway. For testing, doesn't matter if you're really running on a big supercomputer. You run with three virtual CPUs. We share a bit the job. But I think it's useful, that's what we try to do, to have everything. So this will really do everything. We'll install your code and run tests. To try to keep it within a few minutes. Anyway, I think there is a maximum limit of half an hour because it's free. If you pay, you can get more, of course. Or anyway, you can have other things. You can even, I mean, you see, in the end, all this amounts to get Ubuntu, and you could potentially do it in a Docker and run these two scripts. So you could do, once you have this, it's very easy for you to maybe have a flag here which says full test equal to true, that you can run in a different environment. So you have a supercomputer, and say, this you do every commit, and maybe every night you run something which runs for 2 hours. In the end, the tests you have to write are always the same. Just the parameters you pass are different. So it's really a matter of how you design it. But yeah.
Well, I said we would write back these tests to the core function or something like this. So these tests be some apart here?
Yeah, so that's correct. So there are two ways. Say what we are suggesting, it's mainly for us to coordinate. It's mainly for Max, probably. You want to have in this repository the basic tests for a few plugins. So we know those, I don't know, four plugins work at that version at least. And we have a test for them. And if you want, a test is also automatic documentation because you can go through it and see how you submit and what you should expect to get. If you want to embed the test in your code, in your plugin repository, then you have to, instead of contributing back, you take the template folder, you move it in your repository, and then this Travis thing works. I mean, because this works, say, this will test at every commit in our repository. The idea, you take exactly the same template, you move it in your repository, and then it runs at every commit in your repository, which is what you eventually want. We didn't, yeah, you're right, you didn't explain because it was a bit more technical, and you're already one, so. Do you have more questions? Okay, so if not, first of all, thank you very much for being here. We'll meet again with the Max people at 2, maybe 2:20. You see now, we can even go for lunch all together if you want. We hope this was useful. Some things were a bit technical. We really wanted to show you, however, the basic tools to allow you to do something. So to show how to run workflows, how to work with the new plugins if you want to develop one, and how to make the test automatic. Because this will also not only help you developing, but also help us to track what's happening in the plugin, what are the actual features which are there, and then a third person come, just look at examples, and understand what the plugins can do. That's it. Thank you again. And if you want to go for lunch, we can meet here and go together.